Each ethnic, racial group displays a different set of strengths and vulnerabilities that can serve as a guide to what requires special attention during caregiver assessment and treatment. For Koreans, strong beliefs in filial obligation, language limitations, and low levels of acculturation and health literacy may be present. Again, this is not true across the board, but when these factors are present, their combined influence appears to make caregiving more stressful because they are less likely to use formal caregiving or support system. Korean American caregivers are often reluctant to openly admit their distress, relying instead on more indirect means of expression. Those who have limited knowledge of English for both reading and writing also have less accurate information about dementia, less access to the healthcare system in general, and use fewer formal support services. Cultural beliefs and practices such as strong family ties and religiosity can buffer and protect caregivers from negative health outcomes of caregiving. However, other cultural premises such as filial obligation, familism, and face-saving carry special hazards. As mentioned by Dr. Lee, Korean American family caregivers with dementia continue to depend on informal caregivers, usually female family members. Korean family caregivers are predominantly first-generation immigrants and are often left without systematic help. This is what they are experiencing in caregiving situation. Korean immigrant caregivers who have a strong sense of filial obligations are reluctant to seek assistance from outside of home, and the lack of sufficient resources exist. There is also strong social stigma associated with seeking outside help. Moving to next box, dissatisfaction with mainstream healthcare system is also related to reluctance to use formal support among immigrant Korean caregivers. Language and food were the main barriers to adequate and satisfactory service. Even when the language was not an issue, Korean immigrants are often ambivalent about the use of formal services, and use of such services were seen as a last resort. They tend to think U.S. care providers cannot understand Korean caregivers. Even though more facilities with Korean-speaking nurses, practitioners, and staffs are available than before, Korean caregivers talk about being unable to find the culturally acceptable adequate alternatives. Establishing Korean shelters or nursing homes and training Korean home health aides is greatly needed. And help from Korean volunteers would be a good strategy to help Korean immigrant families in elder care. Mainstream agencies can recruit and train qualified interpreters or volunteers and offer ongoing transcultural education for existing professionals. In addition, information can be provided in Korean language to help Korean immigrant caregivers access to formal services. These common themes related to caregiving situation among Korean immigrants were already covered by Dr. Lee, but I am going to quote a few comments made by real Korean family caregivers in dementia caregiving situations. It is a burden because I have to earn money. However, does not mean I'm unwilling to take care of parent. My families get angry rather than soothe me. They say, "Can't you endure even that little thing?" I don't want my children to take care of me. I want an independent life with dignity. I don't want to be left alone in an empty house. It would still be best if adult children can take care of their parents. Formal services cannot provide love. They could speak only English and provided American food only, but she couldn't eat them. She had eaten Korean foods for almost 80 years. Then what can we do with Korean family caregivers? There are kind of few recommendations. We can try recognize, assess Korean family caregivers' risk of negative experiences and adverse consequences for their own well-being. Also, we can try understand changing cultural norms such as coexistence of filial piety and filial autonomy and life context of Korean family caregivers. Also, we can try provide education and intervention to enhance coping skills in relation to caregiving and to promote caregivers' well-being. Also, we can try identify and develop more culturally appropriate support services.
I would like to thank Drs. Kwan and Lee for their excellent review of the knowledge base we have on dementia and caregiving among Korean American elders. In summary, we can say that there's a lot we have to learn about this growing and diverse population. We're fortunate to have some major screening instruments available that have been validated among Koreans. We need to remember that most Korean elders still speak little or no English, and that caregivers have the added stress of being expected to provide care within the family setting without much help from formal services. So with that, I would like to thank you for your participation and let you know if you have any questions, please feel free to contact the Stanford Geriatric Education Center.